Hello and welcome to this very special broadcast. We're counting it down to the big election in the state of Maharashtra. And so we decided this time, in association with Times of India, that we're going to have a slightly different conversation. This is not going to be a regular tutu meme debate between various politicians. This is going to be a constructive conversation between the citizens and the politicians. And we will be talking about what the citizens want in the manifesto for Mumbai. We're calling it the Mumbai Manifesto. It's actually an initiative that has been started by Times of India. They call it entries from citizens, large groups, societies and trusts. They all got together, put in what they want in the manifesto from the political parties, spoke about what the next government should do for the citizens of Mumbai. What does the Mumbaikar want? And today, we're going to have a conversation about some of those issues. And actually, there are three big themes that are lined up. First theme is housing. Then we will focus on healthcare and education. And of course, on transport. One of the most burning issues right now is transport, increasing public transport, integrated transport for Mumbai and other cities. So let me introduce you to our guests with me from Times of India, our colleagues, Vaibhav Purandare, Deputy Resident Editor for Times of India, and Nazir Bharucha, thank you so much, Senior Editor of TOI, joining us. And they'll also be pitching in, you know, with thoughts and specific questions that they have for our politicians as well. Let's start with the citizen side. I have Mr. Ravi Duggal, health researcher and an activist. Mr. Kedarnath Ghorpade, former chief of MMRDA. Thank you so much for joining us. Chandrashekhar Prabhu, housing activist, a regular also on Mirror Now in many of our conversations. And Rekha Sani, thank you so much, ex-principal for Kamla High School. And on the other side, representing the political parties, I've got Mr. Bhalchandra Mungerkar, Congress Party representative, also former VC of the Mumbai University. So an expert when it comes to many of the subjects that we will be talking about today. Manisha Kayande, thank you so much for joining us, representative of Shiv Sena. And I have Mr. Atul Shah of the BJP. Thank you for joining us. So let me start with the citizen side. Let's begin with housing. Mr. Prabhu, do you want to take off on what should the next government do when it comes to availability of homes in this city that has no space?
Well, the government has already done what they have said. They've said every citizen in every city will get a house according to his needs and affordability. Now, when this was said by the government, everyone said that this is impossible to achieve. I am an expert in this subject. I said, no, it is possible to give. The government should come out with a time-bound program, and it is possible to give every citizen a house according to his affordability. We said this, it's been 5 years down the line. However, for the citizens of Mumbai, we don't think there are any schemes to give housing for all. Instead, what is touted to be affordable housing scheme tends to push the Mumbai residents out of Mumbai to Panvel, to Nalasopara, to Kalyan, to Dombivli, and so on, which is not exactly what the promise was.
So, okay, so far, let me take that point across, because we've been speaking about affordable housing, we've been speaking about redevelopment and, you know, converting these slums into proper homes. It was the biggest issue 7 to 8 years ago. It just kind of went nowhere. Would any of you like to start with where we've gone wrong and what should be the policy?
Housing for all. The Prime Minister of this country has, you know, promised to the electorate that there'll be a house for everyone by 2022. In as far as Mumbai is concerned, yes, we don't have any land bank, but still the state government is striving hard to do it. In Goregaon, in Motilal Nagar, we've got all that ready. About 40,000 houses are going to be given. In Upper Hila area of Goregaon also, we are going to do it. Plus, now, Mahara, Mr. Prabhu said people are going outside. There is no land in Mumbai. At least there'll be affordable houses on the outskirts of Mumbai. The working is going on. The biggest BDD chawl now is going to be developed And there'll be, after the rehabilitation, there'll be areas given to the people who can afford them. So this government is sincerely trying to give houses to all, and we are working very hard on that. And the next government, with definitely the BJP Shiv Sena is going to come in power, will have more such hyper actively this government is going to work, because it is the dream of the Prime Minister of the country. We're looking at the people's dreams, that their aspirations for housing should be completed.
No, but if you're saying that the homes are not affordable because the line prices are such, I see all these fancy projects all over the city, 4 crore, 5 crore, nothing below that. Obviously, they're not affordable by any standards.
No, you're talking about all these areas.
Correct.
Allied areas.
So we're talking about affordable housing.
But with the schemes coming up, and with the housing stock increasing, the rates will definitely come
down. What is the scheme that you're talking about? Are you talking about housing for all announced by the Prime Minister?
I'm talking about the BDD chawl. I'm talking about the other affordable housing that we are going to make.
First of all, the BDD chawl scheme.
We've
also, from 4 to 15, FSI also has been increased. So we'll have development. We have changed the rule of MADA also now. Earlier, we had this repair board, and that 33-7 had come. But now we are asking, MADA is going to do on its own. This is in annual.
Okay.
There's another matter of concern where the government is now pushing for a proposal to build so-called affordable homes on saltpant lands in Mumbai.
I would like to come in there.
Can you just...
I think ours is the only party who has opposed this tooth and nail. In the last cabinet meeting also, our minister, environment minister, has opposed this, because the salt pan land, it is basically a flood prevention measure.
Correct.
I myself have a research paper on that with climate mitigation issues. So I think that ours is the only party which has opposed it. Because under the garb of calling it low-cost housing, it should not be a land-grabbing measure for some
Correct.
Of the top builders. And I think that...
I agree
Let me just complete.
There is a proposal with the government right now where a developer has submitted a proposal to construct 1 lakh affordable homes on saltpant lands in the eastern suburbs.
I think that
no
would
decision
be,
has
that
been
would
taken
be disastrous.
So far,
it would
but
be
it's
disastrous.
There. It's officially...
The government is looking at the avenues. You know, saltpant land is one of the avenues. Without the permission and without the environment clearance, nothing is going to happen.
With the environment clearance, we know what is happening.
Yes. We have to look at the avenues. This is, I told at the beginning, that Mumbai doesn't have a land bank.
I don't agree there. Mumbai, under the Urban Land Ceiling Act, has 1,875 hectares of surplus land, which was supposed to be taken under the Urban Land Ceiling Act. The Urban Land Ceiling Act has been scrapped. So this land was available. No one knew who will get it. Activists went to court, and the Bombay High Court gave a judgment very clearly that this land should be taken over by government and used for affordable housing. Mind you, this entire land is within Mumbai limits, and Justice Dharmadhikari's judgment is there. Now, the judgment was challenged by the builders in the Supreme Court, and Supreme Court gave a stay. It was expected that the government fight for this land in the Supreme Court. However, it is shocking that the government signed consent terms with the builders to see that this 1,800 hectares of land will be handed over to builders if they pay certain amount of money, which is a part
of the premium.
So
may I actually just at this point of time
so
bring in Mr. Gorpati
as well? So this land is available. What is available you are giving to builders?
What happens again and again?
And you are using salt pan lands for the housing?
What happens again and again? One minute, please.
There is a small comment about this.
I will come to you. I want to bring in one more citizen voice.
Which are at risk. I think that's the
much
larger
risk. So the point is that you will say the mangroves are at risk, the RA is at risk, the salt pans are at risk. We've encroached the river plain, we've built on it, which is why we keep seeing flooding in parts of our city at risk. Is there a disconnect between what is available, what the policy can be, and what we end up implementing because of, say,
See,
a nexus with the builder? And I'm not saying with one political party, Mr. Ghorpade, but when it comes to the planning, do we go haywire keeping other interests in mind?
I think what really happens in case of Mumbai, it's the land limitation or the land crunch. I think I've been hearing this for many, many years, and the only way Mumbai can grow is, I think, increasing the FSI. I think that's what we have been doing. That's one part. Secondly, the mechanism by which we have so far seen by research is that the areas which are marginal, they slowly get encroached or they get a part of the, I would say, land supply with, I would still call it an affordable housing. But there are incentives which has been given to improve the housing condition, because very, very inhabitable conditions. If you see some of these, you know, the settlements which are there, even if you say Malavni or say Vadala or you say Chembur or Mankhod, I think what really happens is it's a very, very pathetic, I would say, living conditions.
So let me ask you, Mr. Mungaikar, are our housing policies now, not just now, but for now decades together, only meant for the builders?
Two things need to be mentioned. This entire discussion has to be seen into certain theoretical framework. And that framework is, Mumbai belongs to whom? Next May, I shall be completing 60 years in my stay in Mumbai. And I have been daily saying that Mumbai is slowly dying. Mumbai is virtually dying. And this process has been exaggerated, or rather exasperated, during last 30 years. The question is, as Mr. Prabhu just now mentioned, affordability is it is absolutely meaningless term. For the very simple reason that according to him, 98% people cannot be considered eligible for affordable housing. That is the reason that government started constructing houses under the category of affordability at Kambala Hill. See, that the government was in 1960s and 70s, when Motilal Nagar, Vikaroli, Ghatkopar, etc., Pantanagar, they were constructing houses, lower income group, middle income group, and higher income group.
In fact, Mada did a very good job in the 70s.
Absolutely. And that's what...
Low income, middle income colonies came up during that period.
That is why I had, in 1976, I had purchased a house for 19,600 rupees, out of which 4,000 I paid, and 15,000 I was taken the loan from the government of Maharashtra. The question is, Mumbai city today, practically working only for top 20-25% of the people. Rest of the people, irrespective of caste, language and region, do not have any entitlement so far as it is concerned. This is true for education, this is true for health, that will be coming afterward.
Yes.
This is for each and every practical purposes. That's why the term affordability is absolutely rendered meaningless. The last point in this case, the land belongs to me in Maharashtra, in Mumbai. Now, Mr. Shah just now mentioning that this land crunch. Now, land crunch is not... See, land, according to classical economics, doesn't have supply price. Today, 12 lakh flats are vacant in Mumbai. Only
Correct.
For speculative interest.
Correct.
Now, in a country where thousands and lakhs of people are not getting any kind of house...
And they're rotting. Those buildings are rotting now.
No, those buildings, because now what happened, their bargaining power is so much, it has vicious circle. 12 lakh crores of NPAs. These NPAs, 50% are locked up in the real estate. There is no demand. This 85-story building that you are saying, they are not booked. That is just Keynesian speculative motive for getting the profit. And government virtually no control. And let me tell you very frankly, irrespective of political party, these things are happening only because...
But what is the solution? You are telling me the problem.
Clear cut.
You
forget about
what
time being Shiv Sena, BJP, Congress. I am making responsible statement. I represent citizen first and then the party. There is clear-cut nexus, political, economic and profit-oriented between the political class and the builders in that. That is creating the problem so far housing is concerned.
So I want to say something.
Yeah, I would like
one minute. Yes.
See, this was the SRA scheme was launched during the previous
Correct.
Shiv Sena, BJP government, 95.
Yes.
The scheme as such was good. Okay, Balasaheb Thackeray saw that the city should be rid of the chopadpattis. And then the scheme came up. But then we saw that even that scheme had so many problems. And then again, there were fights between the residents. So even the residents' expectations are getting too high. Now, even if any redevelopment project, the residents feel that they should get 2 bedrooms extra. And so this is leading to so much of chaos within
But ma'am, don't you think this policy should have been reviewed after 25 years?
Yes.
The policy has not even been reviewed.
Now the policy has been reviewed. And the MADA is coming up with its own.
SRA.
No, no, SRA policy has not been from reviewed. 1995 till today, we are talking of 23 years or 24 years. We needed 15 lakh houses to be built. In 23 years, we have built 1,12,830 houses. At this rate, it will take 400 years to build houses.
Okay, so two people wanted to make a point. Yes, Weber first and then Mr. Dugal. Yes, Weber first. Yes.
No, I wanted to make a point about worries concerned about BDD Chawl's redevelopment. Manisha Kayanthi now said that, you know, the SRA scheme went in a particular direction. Now, there is a worry that the BDD Chawl redevelopment will also go in the same direction, in the sense that all of this will be rebuilt and the people staying there will eventually leave. Others will come in. They will be thrown out to Kalyan, Bhiwandi, Dombivli, God knows where. So is the Shiv Sena going to stop this? You may have a legislator from Worli, possibly, this time.
Yeah.
The Thackeray dynasty, and will the BJP stop this? Because then the question, as he said, who does Mumbai belong to? You will throw out people who've been living there for ages.
Yeah, I would like to come in. See, now we built houses for the mill workers, okay? And there we saw to it that they are getting the houses. But another thing which came up was they are selling their houses and going somewhere else.
Yeah, so that is a challenge.
So that is another, that was another challenge, that they sell their houses.
So what will you do to stop them? Yeah.
45,000.
Can I just please listen to the answer? There's a question here. What will you do to stop this?
Well, now we normally make agreements that you cannot sell for 10 years.
Huh.
These are the sort of agreements made.
I'm giving a solution to this. 45,000 mill workers have given an affidavit to the government. I took their representatives myself to the chief minister. And they have said that this scheme for government building us houses into 25-storied building.
Right.
We can't afford it. We have to sell it. Hence, government should take over the urban land ceiling land and give us the land. We will, at our expense, 45,000 mill workers have said, we don't want anything from the government. You give your subsidy, whatever we will build for ourselves and we will live there. We will not sell it. But the government says, no, we will build and give it to you.
Okay. No, anyway, one-third of the mill land was supposed to be given for affordable housing for mill workers, mainly.
Yes. That's not happening.
Yeah, I want to go back to the policy perspective question. I think that is the crux of the problem because, you know, the topics we're discussing today, health, education, housing, transport, these are all should be in the domain of rights.
Right.
Not in schemes. Schemes lead to scheming. That is what has been happening all these years. So I think we need to change that policy perspective and establish the right to housing and have public housing. Why should people be owning houses only?
Right.
There should be public housing like as a social security.
Like
you have in UK, for example, or in many European countries.
Is it possible, Mr. Shah, in a city like Mumbai, especially in a city like Mumbai?
All the avenues. This government is sincere and honest. That's the reason the Prime Minister has announced this. So any avenues which are available, this government will ponder upon it. At the moment, we are changing. I mean, BDD, we are doing it. We are also planning for Dharavi, redevelopment. That is also happening. So everything is that. This government sincerity, nobody will doubt. Because last, Mr. Mungaikar is here.
Then where is the choke point? Explain to us, the Dharavi redevelopment has been spoken about for a decade. I'll add one little part.
We have only 5 years now. The problem is so huge. This government, Devendra Fadnavis, has looked into so many aspects. The discussion today of transport, health, everything, we'll come to that.
Okay.
Only 2 seconds.
Yes.
I will request my colleague, okay, but he's very close friend of mine. Let us keep for time being Honorable Prime Minister out of discussion for the very simple reason.
Why not?
No, no, no.
Why not?
No, no, I'm just a minute.
Are you allergic to the Prime Minister?
No, no, I'm
Prime Minister.
I said, Orin, my.
Delivers the message to the nation.
My dear friend, what I'm saying is.
You know,
I said Honorable.
Okay, okay.
The Prime Minister.
No, 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 my point is.
I said it. I said in the beginning of this debate that this is not one of those Tutu Meme debates. Let's come back to the constructive
point I was making.
Yes.
Let us keep him out of the discussion because he is not concerned with any of the real issues facing the country. That's my argument.
Okay, but this is for more for the local legislators right now to tell us.
Your party is not concerned.
And what the government will do. Mr. Gorpati,
my
one
comment.
Yes, Mr. Gorpati.
What we were talking about, you know, affordability. I think if we are aware of a place called Charko, Gorai, Varsova, Kopar Khairane, I think this was a scheme which was started way back in 1984-85, which was financed by the World Bank called the Affordable Low Income Shelter Program. And we called it as Mumbai Urban Development Project. It was a program and then there was a project. And I think we developed fairly about 500 hectares of land. And it was affordable in the sense there were site and services schemes. And anybody can go and visit and check what has really happened. It has given the accessibility. So what we need to really look at is how do you create opportunities for people to access the land? And you will find we built 25, 30, 40, 60, and 100 square meter row houses. And then we also do, I wouldn't say cross subsidy, but differential pricing was done. And we had apartment plots. And if you go today, I am doing a lot of work there, and even in Kopar Khairane, I think in Navi Mumbai, because I stay there, I'll just give a case there, that Kopar Khairane, which is about 117.59 hectares, I think it is actually acting as a labor, employment, housing, and all services. You want, where do you stay? You ask anybody, he will say, he or she will say, I stay
and
in
best, best possible habitation today in Mumbai, Kopar Khairane.
See, what we are looking for is creating accessibility to
Absolutely.
People.
Okay.
So if that right. becomes
except,
opportunity,
except for fact,
and affordability is across the board.
I'm
you know, for 25, 30, 40.
I'm doing 12 projects.
Mr. Prabhu, I just want to, where he has finished, see, accessibility, that is the reason. This government, first thing they did was to have a metro plans, metro railways, 14 in metro all over the city, and the work is going at such a rapid pace that Agreed. We will have that accessibility easy and comfortable also. 14 line, it will go to Navi Mumbai, it will go to Kalyan, it will go to different parts of, and from my Girgaon to airport, I can reach in 20 minutes time. Nowadays, I'm taking 2 hours. So accessibility. Now you said the people will be thrown out of Mumbai. That is, we have to make it accessible. That is very important. That is what we are focusing upon, and this is what the government is comfortable travel to the commuters and the accessibility that he can reach his home, his destination quicker and in a comfortable way.
I think that's not accessibility is something different.
Yes. Yes.
But when people living in the city, who were living in the city and are now for some reason
going out
to Badlapur, Ambarnath, why? They should be
that
staying at their own places.
Exactly.
People are dislocated from their own houses.
Right.
They are going somewhere else.
There was an entire idea that even BJP had to develop more clusters like, say, the BKC in different parts of Mumbai. So people don't have to travel 3 hours just to get to their workplace.
I mean, why should a person...
What happened to that? You make
the
city unaffordable and then you make them go out.
I'm a corporator today.
Right.
We've got a very successful cluster going on now. SBUT, it is known as Safi Burani Urban Trust, which is doing it. We are going to have similar. I worked upon one cluster in Kumbharwada, which is another area, and Kamatipura. So we are working on it. And this cluster is the answer for the people to have their own premises in their own locality,
Absolutely.
Where we'll give more FSI, as I said earlier,
see
from
the,
4
see
to
See
15.
The Burani Trust progress has been from the year 1990. It has not come in the last 5 years or so. And the proposal was put up in 1991.
Whoever does it, Mr. Prabhu, I am saying that similarly, the clusters
so,
can be done.
So don't you take credit for something which you have
not
done.
If we somehow solve the problem of housing at some point, what happens along with that for the rest of the infrastructure? You have healthcare and you have education. Rekha Swani, do you want to start off with, when it comes to education, what should the next government focus on?
Well, I think if you get the education right, the country will be right. And the fear that the citizens are facing at this moment is there is no clarity and there is no transparency in where the money that is coming from the government is going in education. So we have schools that are empty and no students. We have schools that have extra teachers, but they are not given in other schools which do not have teachers. So there are a lot of issues that bother the citizen and the parents especially. And also, besides the governance and the transparency part, we have come up with new things in education. You know, we have different systems. When we were growing up, we had either the state government, state education, or the ICSE. But now suddenly we have like 10 boards coming up, which is progressive. But are we very clear about what next? Is the parent aware that my child after 10 years will be able to reach a certain situation? Mm. Like in Maharashtra itself, we have come up with the international board. Does that give us an exposure to the world because the word international is used? Or are we equipping our teachers with that knowledge of this is what the child is going to need after 10 years of education or 20 years of education? Also, are we focusing on 0 to 6 years or 7 years of early childhood of a child? So we need to have a clear mandate in every area where the children are concerned, where the teachers are concerned, where all the stakeholders are concerned. Are we really educating our teachers? Because our B.Ed and D.Ed education, sorry, is not updated at all. We get teachers with a degree, but who doesn't have the skill even to smile in a class. Mm. You cannot teach a subject just like that. So, and there's a lot of money going in education, but are we really utilizing in human resources? Are we realizing and putting it only in the structures?
There was a study that came out just recently, last week, that actually spoke about this. The quality of education, what the children are understanding, even if it comes to their basic math, is really abysmal. And I in my hand, actually, are, you know, excerpts of manifestos of all three political parties here, and I don't find much when it comes to education from 2014. Why is that, Mr. Shah? Let's start with you.
No, no, education is very important. Government is definitely looking. The education budget has been increased, definitely. But the what madam has said, right, there's so much of complication that this government is now taking up all these measures. And as far as, now we have to differentiate. Now Mumbai city, the demands are, you know, very, the municipal schools are running empty. We are working on that also. The Mumbai Municipal Corporation, plus with the corporators, we are coming up with the new ideas and the premises, how it can be private corporation participation.
You
and
you are shutting down these schools.
No, no.
Is there an alternate plan? Because there has to be some...
86
you know,
schools have been shut down.
Public-sponsored education
that we are
institution.
Coming up with that issue also is very important issue.
Sir, our basic concern is all over the world we see children going in public schools more than private schools. Today, children, parents are spending so much for private school. Why are we missing out on that quality education? And it's been a mandate for all these years. It has been a mandate. But somewhere we are missing out on that quality education. And I think we need to focus on that. Somewhere we need to see the transparency.
Where I
the
would like to intervene.
Yes.
Because being an educationist myself and also on the education committee of MMC, see, Mumbai Mahanagar Palika schools are the only one in, I would say, the entire world which teaches in 8 different languages. Mm. And maybe some schools, many schools in the city are closing down, but the schools in the suburbs are flourishing. Mm. And we have built huge buildings in the suburbs. Another thing is we are digitalizing the education. We have virtual classroom, which we have strengthened it. Hmm. Secondly, through teaching through apps, teaching through tabs, distribution of tabs was one of the major things that
no,
Shiv Sena did.
If you digitize and you have virtual classrooms, does that solve the problem of good teachers?
Ma'am, I agree.
Of course it's solved.
I'm sorry, but yeah. I agree. Tomorrow robotics will come. But where's that human touch that our children
no,
really need?
We are not losing the human touch. But of course, see, education is one thing which is plagued with many problems. Because of the several boards, basically the schools in the mother tongue. I mean, no parent is ready to teach their child today in the parent's mother tongue. Mm.
The biggest nightmare for a family, for a couple who gets married, the biggest nightmare
so
is if you have a
admission.
Child, the admission is
correct.
A problem.
Correct.
Look at the kind of huge amounts you have to pay for admission.
Sir, that is
well,
because
in the BMC, once let me finish this. In the BMC, we are giving 27 supportive material to the children, right from the slippers and the uniform and the boxes and lunch and everything. So there are 27 things that we are giving.
Okay, no,
but the thing is that this caters only to the very poor most people.
Yes. No, I want to go back to that point that you raised and we'll get a response. Mr. Dukal, you want to add to that?
I think where education is concerned, if you look back in the 60s and 70s, BMC schools were one of the best in the country. I mean, they were on par with today's what you call the Delhi public schools, etc. They were probably better. And they were free education. What happened in later in the 70s, late 70s and early 80s, this whole mechanism where the state took over, you know, this whole grant in aid mechanism which
grant
evolved,
in aid,
that destroyed the public health, public education system.
Right.
So BMC schools, the middle classes pulled out the children from these schools. It collapsed. It became schools for the poor, people living in slums.
Yeah.
So I think that's precisely part
and
of the
many
problem.
Many of these schools are located
so
in the
how
slum.
Do we fix that problem?
Let me
yes.
see. I, have some, I have got some mild claim on education after 40 years and since why.
Correct.
So the question is, it is twofold question. One question is, we missed the bus in 1946, 47. I made the first statement because we could not develop the system which is relevant for pre-India. We continued the same system, okay, that was consistent with the requirements of imperial society, imperial government. Having said this, today we are spending at an aggregate level 3.5% of the total GDP on education, whereas in 1966, Kothari Commission suggested 6% in 1966. Maharashtra is the only state which is spending on education least. As Dugal just now mentioned, 20 years ago, 15 years ago, teachers were trying their level best to get the job of teaching in the municipal school. Yesterday only at municipal school, they are giving 27, the article for the students. But today, Maharashtra is the only state in the country since I was in the planning commission, which has most ad hoc education policy, inconsistence, carelessness, all ad hoc decisions. I will give you a simple illustration. ICSE board and Maharashtra secondary education board, they change the which mark should be taken for the SSC 11th standard admission. They change after admission began. Initially, the point was the best possible 5 subject mark should be taken. They realized later on, Mr. Vinod Tavde said, that we are reducing that inflation of the marks. And then they realize SSC board students are not getting admission. That's why after the first state of admission began, they changed that only first top 5 mark subjects should be given.
Right.
First 5. It means my granddaughter had got 100 marks out of 100 in copper. There were 6 subjects. I had to file case against government of Maharashtra. Mr. Dharbadikari was the judge and he got the judgment. And as a result of which, they had to tender apology and file the affidavit. Most inconsistent state, most careless state, and most absolutely least expenditure on education compared to Andhra Pradesh, Tamil Nadu, Karnataka, okay, is the Maharashtra government.
So my point is,
we have given Congress Party Manifesto. We know the I have drafted the manifesto to the large extent. We are living with these problems. We try to solve the problem by spending more and importing the education. Giving instruments is not the mechanism for that. Actually teaching them the capacity, building them empowerment, building them understanding, retention of knowledge, keeping them live to make the problem solving. Okay, understanding.
Okay.
This is
but
the
I
policy.
Think that, I think a lot of it depends on one of the best teachers.
BMC
schools
have
got very good teachers.
Yeah.
So the only thing is that they are located in the slum. The people go from the slums, and so the middle class and, of course, the upper middle class don't want to send their students
only
there.
The poorest students,
only the poorest students go.
Only today the crisis is, maybe poorest students, Urdu, 66,000 students, and Hindi, 65,000 students. Total students are around 1.6.
But that is not the fault of the government.
No. My only point is today, there are, madam, 19 primary education schemes in the country. Education is the most important instrument of injecting inequality.
Okay, yes.
I want to say something here. On the one hand, we are spending very little on education.
Very little.
So will the next government, if yours is elected or yours is elected, increase the amount spent on education? Second, is you're not spending enough, and on the other hand, fees are unaffordable for for students and their parents. You know, it's education has become a very expensive affair.
That was a valid point. What about the city of Mumbai? What about the fee structure?
We have right to education. At least in education, there is a right.
Yes.
But what has happened to that? Since the right to education has come in, there's been more privatization, much more rapid privatization of education.
The private schools don't want to be part of the right to education. They don't want to subsidize it. They complain that the government never pays them.
Minority institutions are excluded from all other things.
So, Mr. Shah, let's begin with this. When it comes to right to education.
Ask me about increasing the budget. This government is definitely, we are also coming up with our manifesto. We are increasing the education. It's a need of the hour. I understand. And the intricacies, Mr. Mungekar is an expert. He was a chancellor, I appreciate. But the party he belongs to never thought of all this for all these years. And this has led to such a big problem in education. This government is very sincere. And as Mr. Purandare said, yes, we are increasing the budget on education for
but
sure.
But there are schools that are complaining constantly. Yeah. Government-aided schools say they don't get the aid from the government. You give us a series of excuses
25,000
that there is a problem with the records. We don't know how much money has to be
increasing
given.
Increasing the budget.
Under right to education, private schools don't want to be
25,000 schools today are completely unaided. Government of Maharashtra started getting undertaken an affidavit that if you want to start the school, then give the guarantee that it will be permanently unaided. That is the only state in the country which is in the name of Ambedkar, Phule, Shahu, and Savitribai Phule. This is pathetic condition. That's why we promise.
But
I wrote myself.
During Congress's time.
Forget about Madam Congress.
Then you say I'm a citizen.
No, I started that. But how do we believe that if the Congress comes back to power, it changes, Mr. Mungekar? There were 20, Mr. Shah just now saying, 1951, there were 25 universities. Today, there are 600 universities.
So how do we believe that if Congress comes back to power, you will make these changes?
Are they going to close down all these 600?
At least I have to take the responsibility because I have drafted that. My only point is that education and health, these are two drivers of economic development. Now, Congress government, whatever has done, I don't want to go into that. But then Mr. Shah should mention that he also got education up to graduation with the institution was created by the Congress party.
Okay.
Then 51, only 25 universities, today 600, 30,000 colleges, 22 million students are going to the enrollment ratio.
Yes, but
this happened only during the last 5 years. That's why let us know. I don't want BJP Shivsena, BJP Shivsena Congress party. I am talking as a citizen. In fact, I should have sat there. My only question is I am introspecting.
That is the easy way out. But you wanted to make a point, yes.
There's a very simple explanation to the absence of quality of education.
Yeah.
You compare Kendriya Vidyalayas
with
the state-run schools.
Correct.
Kendriya Vidyalayas have a budget of 36 to 40,000 per student per year. The state schools have 12 to 13,000. That tells you the story.
Right.
Why there is much better education.
Right.
Of course, the Kendriya Vidyalaya also cater to children of Sarkari Babus.
Yeah. Right.
And what about educational institutes turning into profit-making institutions?
To health,
the fees, fees getting out of hand.
Exactly. You know? The
It's a business enterprise.
As in charge of education, the Planning Commission,
yeah,
across the country and drafted the chapter of 11th five-year plan, I have come to the conclusion, and please, I'm like this to my colleagues. I'm not talking from political partisan view. I'm not belonging to that clan. My clan is right or wrong.
The point you were making, Mr. Mungekar,
my only point is, today in the country, without any investment, the most profitable business is the education. That is the end of everything.
All right. So there are two aspects to this. Privatization of education or private institutions in education is fine as long as I believe, as long as the government does its bit, as long as the government sponsors schools and the public education is a good, strong system. Yes, let's talk about healthcare because, again, it's the same concept. You may have these private hospitals who charge you what they want to charge you and provide you those services, but what about public healthcare systems?
The story for health is similar to education.
Correct.
Or for housing also.
Yeah.
So a lot of good things happened in the 60s, 70s, or even up to 80s in healthcare. And you had good BMC dispensaries, hospitals, very well run. And the reason, I'll again trace it back to budgets. If you look at, I've done a historical analysis of budgets from 1960 onwards, of BMC budgets. between 60 and 80, the average budget of the BMC, 25 to 30% was spent on healthcare.
But at that time, the population of the Mumbai was also...
That doesn't matter.
No, it does matter.
It doesn't matter, gentlemen.
It does matter.
How does it matter? I'm talking of...
Why don't we talk about 2019 now? You know, this corporation today, I was in the dental...
Let me finish his point.
Otherwise, we will get distracted.
If you look at historically, there's been a decline.
Okay,
I'll explain the decline.
There's been a decline in budget. Finish the point, yes.
From 60, in the 60s, 70s and 80s, we were spending 25 to 30% of the BMC's budget on healthcare. Today, it's down to 10 to 12%. Okay, 13% for the latest thing. But we know that you underspend and... The actual expenditure is much less. So this has been the trend, and this trend started in the 90s somewhere.
That's right.
That's the time when privatization was happening.
Yes.
In a large way. Insurance came in, which supported the private sector. There was corporatization of healthcare. Drug price control collapsed. You had open markets for drug pricing. So all these factors contributed to the growth of private sector.
But does that necessarily need to be the reason for the collapse of the public sector?
Exactly. That is what happened. So the public system as a result collapsed. So what happened was, for example, all of us in the 60s, 70s and 80s were using the public health system for our health care. Now what happened was in the 90s, health insurance came in. So employers said, we will buy you health insurance. Okay.
Right.
So then you can go to the private sector. Private sector was expanding. This is what happened. So again, the middle classes, like in education, moved out of the public system.
Correct.
And it became a public health
Simply
system.
Simply for
a
the
system
poor
for the
and
poor.
Underprivileged.
No,
yes.
This
yes.
is what happened.
Since Atul Shah, you mentioned Nair Hospital, what I want to ask is that why should everybody who cannot afford private healthcare system go to Nair or to JJ or to KEM? There are thousands of people going there. What happened to neighborhood primary healthcare centers in the city? Why don't we have a decent network run by the, you know, as he
said?
Even it's going on.
Okay.
Still it's there.
Yes, Atul Shah.
And specifically, the Sena can answer because you've been, the Sena has been controlling the BMC for more than 25 years.
BMC hospitals have been expanding. Yeah. New hospitals have come up in the suburbs. I think that we have increased definitely the number of hospitals in the suburbs. In the city too, we have increased. The Sion Hospital has been expanded. The KM Hospital has been upgraded. The Nair Dental is one of the best dental care services. But and of course, it is at a very low cost still, even today. Of course, with the population size, the way Mumbai, due to the major influx.
What is your response to the fact that constantly the budget has gone down, and not just that, the fact that you don't even use what you've budgeted. You don't even use the funds that have been allocated. Why is that?
Well, the consequence of that, of underfinancing, has been that even dedicated doctors have left the public health system.
Underfinancing.
A lot of my friends who worked in the public
system.
And that leads to frustration.
So why is that? Is there a...
Because there are restrictions that they cannot work elsewhere. They cannot...
Why aren't we giving more funds, and why aren't we using the funds that have been allocated?
As far as the funds
is concerned, is that a bureaucratic hurdle? Do the officials
know to do it? No, it's not a bureaucratic hurdle. The funds, we see majority of the funds going in the infrastructure.
Even there they're underutilized.
No, they are not underutilized in the
This is my favorite subject.
I know it's a different subject.
Yes. Okay, so let's talk about some solutions. We know the problems. Yes.
Solution is, all the public hospitals should be properly managed, properly staffed. 50% of the staff of doctors, nurses, and technicians in all the 5 municipal corporations, the posts are vacant. Same is the case with JJ. This is the pathetic condition. The second point is 70,000 patients are going to OPD, to KEM every day. My daughter is psychiatrist there. Third question important is, whatever amount is financed, that amount also is not. Last year, 2018-19, 3,700 crores of rupees total budget, they did not spend even 60%. That's why we have promised that there will be one IIM-like institute in Mumbai. There will be 2 high super specialty hospitals in Mumbai, one in the suburban western, etc., where suburban western and one. But the basic question is, since private, see, let us try to go to the basic question. since well-off sections of the society are taken care of by these super specialty hospital, private hospitals.
Government doesn't
and the
care.
remaining 70-80% people, those who are left to the winds, for them, KEM, Nair, JJ, Sion, like this.
Mr. Shah, you have to
This is the situation.
There is a big problem even in terms of staffing of your existing hospitals, let alone what Vaibhav was saying about additional primary health care centers.
You're right.
Aapke current mein hi nahi hai. Kahan se aayenge?
Not only that, we'll have those centers. And plus, he's talking about AIMS, AIMS Institute. We've already started work in Maharashtra, been sanctioned by central government.
The whole
idea is to give medical aid to people very close by. This is a very good suggestion. Then Mumbai Corporation has one, and some of them are not running properly. I am myself in my area. I'm focusing on that.
Seven Hills and Hospital was Mr. Prabhu. Municipal land was given to a private company and was crores of rupees worth land. Finally, now the municipal commissioner has decided to take it back from the private corporation.
Okay.
1,200 crore worth land given.
Fair enough, yes.
Another thing for this health is concerned, people, the government has started giving Ayushman Bharat, this scheme, the biggest after America into the country in my constituency. Mr. Mungekar ji, now you are bringing Rajiv Gandhi, Sonia Gandhi, then you are saying India first. Now let me complete.
Have changed now. Let us not go into that.
There is no denying the fact that Ayushman Bharat scheme is coming.
He's saying he is not a party person.
Congress's health is deteriorating.
See, this country.
Our health is deteriorating.
You must have given your them, but you have not implemented.
We are very happy.
Here I am talking about 11,000 people already getting a letter for covering and not
right,
only
right.
That.
Let's listen this to the citizens.
Mr. Purandar, let me finish. Tanvi, this government, you know, earlier, now I'm talking about this Congress fellows. The chief minister is getting requisition of medical aid from all over the state. They were spending just 17 crores. And you know the amount of money given by the chief minister last year was 487 crores of rupees to the people of Maharashtra who could not afford the medical, but the chief minister himself, you can check the record.
But you have the scheme, Mr. Shah.
And this is 487.
Mr. Shah, you have the scheme for the people. Where is the infrastructure? Where, which hospital are they going? Which doctor is going to be treating them? That's the big problem.
Wherever they go, they come with a budget. He can even afford in Bridge Candy,
Tanvi,
or he can go to
question.
Mumbai Hospital, Mr. Mungekar.
Atul bhai, I'm asking.
An estimate, and I tell you, Tanvi, I should not be, you know, disturbed this way.
Right.
And this, because I have issued letters,
right.
And people have got medical aid in whichever, irrespective of the hospital. It's a big hospital.
Okay, I thank you.
Mr. Dugal.
See, the Mumbai Mahanagar Palika hospitals not only caters to the people in Mumbai, but they are coming from all over Maharashtra.
What is the percentage?
That's the excuse everywhere. That's the excuse we get everywhere.
Even it's catering to entire Maharashtra.
That's what. But that's what Mr. Kejriwal is also crying about. That's what Yogi Adityanath is also crying about.
No, we agree with that, in fact, but it shows the failure of the state government to develop infrastructure in the rural areas that people have to come all the way to Mumbai.
All these years, last so many years, the Congress fellows, they do nothing.
That is why you are failing.
Okay, no blame game, please. Ravi Dugal. No blame game, please.
I want to take this
today
point
it's about citizens and politicians.
Bharat. Ayushman Bharat today is a scheme which piggybacked on the state schemes which are already there in different states. And they're claiming that this is their contribution over the last 1 year, ek saal ho gaya usko. I think I appreciate the second leg of Ayushman Bharat, which is health and wellness centers, where there is no money being allocated. You need at least 3 times the budget for the existing sub-centers to actually function as health and wellness centers.
They are insured now and they are getting it. You know, there are problems.
Huge fraud.
There are problems. But the sincerity of the government is very important. The credibility of the Congress was just scam. And the credibility of Maharashtra, Devendra Fadnavis, and Mr. Narendra Modi at the center, people trust them, the sincerity. The schemes will come, funds will come.
But I don't see those in the results in health outcomes because Maharashtra is at the bottom. In it per capita expenditure on health, Maharashtra is at the bottom. It is 0.5% of SDP of Maharashtra, which the government is spending on healthcare, which is the lowest in the country.
That is the reason I was trying to tell you. So we need to. The chief minister, since there was no scheme, he spent 500 crores to the people for their healthcare.
Ayushman Bharat is promoting the private sector. That's what it is.
One small.
Okay, we are almost out of time here.
One small intervention.
Yes.
There should be at least 5-6 public hospitals like KEM. And second, like neighboring school concept, in every locality, at least for 4,000 to 5,000 persons, there should be one up-to-date dispensary which can be catering to the immediate medical requirements of the people. Irrespective of the political party, BJP can't say that because Congress failure, we shall fail.
If that is
the case, then continue.
I agree with you to a certain extent. Nobody is denying the faults of Congress. That's why they got kicked out of the power. That's why Congress is in ICU today. But I do not think that can be an excuse for BJP or Shiv Sena anymore. You've been in power now for more than 5 years. You have to show us what you can actually do. We are completely out of time. Anything that you would like to add at this point before we summarize this?
Yes. I think if we look at Mumbai's case, where 60% of the people are living in informal sector.
Right.
So what you visit any slum area, you will find you have enough, I would say, the medical facilities which is locally available.
Right.
You have quite a few of them, most of them BAMS or Ayurvedic or whatever the qualifications are.
Yeah.
So I think what really happens is even when you do a socioeconomic survey, people prefer that it is a walkable distance and that's close by. And the intensity and the density of population which is there, I think what really happens is people go to these people and it's a very, I would say, surviving and a lucrative business to start your whatever small clinic you
want
to
start. Yeah, but that's also very tricky because, the new policy allows alternate medicine people to become full-fledged professional doctors without you ever having to understand who you're going to. So that's a little...
That's a point.
I want to point out the gross inequity in access to healthcare.
Right.
I mean, you look at, for the general population, the healthcare budget of the country as a whole, we are spending only 1,500 rupees per capita. If you look at central government health employees, the CGHS scheme, they spend 8,500 rupees per employee.
Right.
Per person, per capita for the employee and their family. Right.
It's the same example you gave for Kendriya Vidyalaya and state schools.
So ESIS, again, your organized sector, so you get benefits. So it's social security. Why can't you think of social security for the entire population, for health and education? And housing.
Manisha ji, your mic.
The basic test, blood test is just 1 rupee.
Right.
So I think that is one of the...
Okay. We are completely out of time, but I'm glad we managed to have this conversation.
There has to be some cost to everything, at least for the form, filling the form.
Transaction will take 5 minutes.
Well, these are promises. We'll see what happens when whoever comes to power, when they come to power. Thank you so much. I'm sorry, I'm completely out of time, but I'm glad we managed to have a conversation when there were citizen representatives and there were politicians. We were just talking about how this time around, there is not even enough election buzz. We don't even see enough candidates out there campaigning. I don't know why political parties have lost interest, but it is essential because you must listen to the voice of the people. You must understand what they want. Healthcare, education, infrastructure are actually the real election issues that never form part of any political campaign or narrative ahead of elections. But we hope it does, and that you don't forget when you come to power what you have to implement. Thank you so much. Thank you for joining us.